Hey folks, it's Friday, it's 4 p.m. It means it's time for the Whiskey Media Happy Hour.
With apparently Ryan Davis.
With Ryan Davis. I had no idea. This is our live exclusive members only weekly show where we get to hang out with all the different folks from the Whiskey Media family and see what's going on in the worlds of comic books, TV, movies, video games, tech, all that cool stuff.
Yeah.
We've got an exciting hour ahead for you. We've got Easter surprises, we've got giveaways, we've got video games, but let's start off with some fun comic book business. Sarah Lima from ComicVine.com. Sarah, how you doing?
I'm awesome. How are you?
I'm fantastic. I'm having a good time already.
Yeah.
Very excited about our first segment here. Mm-hmm. We've got a special guest, though not in the studio.
No.
You want to tell us?
Isn't that crazy?
It is super crazy. This is, I think, a first for us on the Happy Hour.
I think so.
So we have a special call-in guest. Why don't you tell us a little bit about who we've got here?
So today on the live show, Comic Vine is happy to present Mr. Joshua Hale-Fielkov, who is a Eisner nominated writer. And we're going to talk a little bit about Echoes, which is his current series that he's releasing through Minotaur. And it's really good. Yeah.
Fantastic. Well, I understand we have Joshua on the line. Joshua, are you there? Joshua, can you hear us?
I can hear you guys.
Oh, we can hear you loud and clear, Joshua. How you doing, sir?
I'm doing great. How you guys doing?
Awesome.
Pretty fantastic. Sarah, please take it away.
Okay, so Josh, first of all, congratulations on your Eisner nomination for Tumor. Tumor is really a really great book, but we're not going to really talk about that. I wanted to talk a little bit about Echoes, and issue 4 was recently released, correct?
Correct. Came out like 2 or 3 weeks ago, and then the new one is out. The new / final one is out in like 2 weeks, I think.
Okay, so for those people that may not have heard of Echoes, I mean, this is a horror comic, right?
Kind of. it's you know, I think horror is a broad category. Like, sorry, I'm hearing I hear myself, so that's why I'm talking funny. I apologize. Like, I think that the book is horror in like the broadest sense. It's really a thriller. Mm-hmm. There's no monsters. There's no there's no vampires or werewolves. What's scariest to me out of everything in the world is the awful things that people do to each other.
Right.
So. And so everything I write to me is sort of horror, just because, I try to find the worst things about people.
Because hell is other people, right, Josh?
Hell's on Earth. Yeah. Can you actually tell us a little bit about Echoes? I know it deals with Brian as the main character, and he finds out that his father may have possibly killed a lot of young girls.
The basic premise is Brian and his father have a ton in common. You know, they growing up, Brian suffered from schizophrenia, his dad suffered from schizophrenia. Mm-hmm. You know, they look alike, they act alike, they have the same personality. The difference is, you know, Brian has like gone to therapy and gotten himself kind of cleaned up and put together and really kind of moved on in his life, whereas his father didn't. And so because of that, their relationship has sucked forever, you know. And so Brian goes to kind of say goodbye to his dad. You know, his dad's now dying of Alzheimer's, and his dad makes a deathbed confession to having been this prolific monster, just a serial killer who's killed literally dozens and dozens of little girls over the past 20 or 30 years.
I think we have some images too from the first issue. So we've got a couple panels, and this right here is Brian speaking to his father on his deathbed, right? So how does this come about? You know, Brian discovers that his dad may have killed all these girls.
Yeah, well, so, I mean, so once his dad confesses, you know, he sort of starts to spiral downward, ever downward, as he starts to question, you know, what does that mean, right? Like, if he and his dad have so much in common and are so similar to each other, does that mean that that's inside him too?
Mm-hmm.
So it's like I said, it's not horror in the sense that, you know, there's bodies getting cut up and guts being thrown at you. But I think it's worse than that. Like, I think the thought of to me, the idea of there's something inside you and you don't know what it is, and that it could be there the whole time just waiting to come out, is so terrifying.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and I think we all, and, you know, it came out of, like, the idea of the book came out of me, you know, we were about to have, I was about to have my first kid. And when you're about to be a father, like, those are the things you start to realize, is how what you do and what your parents did have affected you and turned you into who you are, and how you're now, in turn, doing that to your kid. So, you know, when you have a bad day and you yell at your kid remembers that forever.
Right.
You know, it's just you kind of slipping up. So you sort of extrapolate that and make it 1,000 times worse. Mm-hmm. So, what if?
Josh, obviously, you know, kind of some drawing from some personal stuff, but any particular source of inspiration from other mediums outside of comics?
I mean, I love horror movies. I love, like, 70s action thrillers, and I think you see in, like, you look at a movie like The Parallax View,
right?
Which is, like, it's not really a horror movie, but it is terrifying. You know, that feeling of claustrophobia that 70s thrillers have is a huge influence on everything I do. Mm-hmm. You know, and so, like, that stuff probably more than anything. You know, but for me, like, I like to find a way to tell comic stories that are, you know, stories in graphic literature form that are just different, that you don't see done in comics. And I think that, you know, what happens is a lot of horror comics specifically are monster comics.
Mm-hmm.
And because of the nature of comics, they're almost always tongue in cheek.
Right.
There's very few comics that are actually scary.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the way that you like the idea behind Echoes was how do we make a comic that's actually scary? And the way you do that is you make it so insular, and you make it so real and so sort of, you know, so aching that you're hung up with your characters, so that when you have those shock moments, you are physically shocked because you feel like you understand the character and you know the character so well, and he feels like a real person that you actually like. It's almost like it's like a sympathy scare,
right,
rather than a scare.
Now, the hardcover for this book is coming out pretty soon, right?
Yeah, it's in previews for pre-order right now.
Mm-hmm.
It's in the image section. I think it's actually the last page of the image section under Minotaur Press. It's gonna be a meaty hardcover. Like, it's gonna be real thick, and it's only $20. So which is, I think, if you ask me, terrific deal.
A bargain at any price, really.
That's true.
Now you mentioned these shocking moments and trying to tell this type of story in comics. Now, you know, a good majority of people out there, and I imagine a lot of people watching this, you know, definitely immediately associate comics with the superhero style. Are there any advantages or disadvantages that you feel comics give you in trying to tell this particular style of story?
Oh God, it's so much harder. Making a core movie is so easy, because when you make a movie, you have sound and visuals and cuts, right? Like, you only see the moment that you're in,
right,
on a movie. So you have the advantage. I mean, and that's why doing horror in comics is so amazingly hard, because, you know, when you flip the page, you see the whole page.
Mm-hmm.
So your scares. So, you know, realistically, you only get 11 scares per comic, right? If it's a 22-page comic. Because every time you flip the page, like, oh, I'm shocked. And then I read some. And then, oh, I'm shocked. Oh, and then you read some. Like, so there's no... So it's really hard to actually have the kind of effective pacing that you need to do horror. You know, so when you're reading, or when you're, you know, when you're watching Texas Chainsaw Massacre, you know, when every time the chainsaw sound happens, you jump. You know, and it can happen. They can do it 100 times, and you're going to jump 100 times. All they have to do is make the volume a little bit louder each time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that it's coming out of nowhere. Whereas with comics, like, you have to control, the reader.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, what Rasan did just beautifully with the art is we managed to get in, you know, 30 or 40 shocks. Like, you get 30 or 40 scares per issue, because you're actually so sort of the way the pages are shaped and formed, like, you're not reading the whole page. You're reading it beat to beat to beat to beat,
mm-hmm.
which gives you, you know, which in theory gives you the chance to sort of get those extra jumps in.
It's very economical of you.
Yeah, I mean, well, like, you, like, I think to do the sort of stuff that I want to do, like, you have to find new ways to tell stories. And you have to find ways to kind of, you know, trick your audience into going along with it. And I think honestly, like, part of why people have responded so positively to the book is that it really is, it's a very unique reading experience. You know, like, it doesn't feel like anything else on the stands. And, you know, you get, well, like, comics are based around, like, here's the secret, kids. I'm gonna spoil it for everybody.
Uh-oh, break it down here. We're almost out of time, so let's make it a quick secret.
If you write a great page one and a great page 22, you're like 99% done. No, like, really, because that's the thing is, like, what do you remember? You remember those shocks at the end.
Right.
Like, you don't remember all the crap that happens in between. Like, what matters is that cliffhangery end that makes you see the cover of issue two and pick it up, and see the cover of issue three and pick it up. You know, so to kind of break out of that trope and actually keep spinning the story so that it's not just at the issue breaks that you're getting a flop, that the story is flopping, but you're actually getting it throughout the issue, so that what you think the book is about and what the book is actually about is constantly changing and shifting. It's certainly the hardest thing I've ever had to write. Like, it took a hell of a lot out of me to get this thing done, and I needed a break afterwards.
Well, I hope that you get it, Joshua.
Yeah. This is an awesome, awesome book. So, thank you so much for this interview on our live show, and hopefully everybody can, you know, give it a chance. Hardcover's coming out pretty soon.
Yeah, one more time, Josh, give us the plugs, what you've got coming out, where people can get it.
Well, so Echoes, so Tumor is still available. That's the one that's nominated for an Eisner. Mm-hmm. You can get it on Amazon or at your local comic shop. Echoes issue 5 comes out in like 2 weeks, and then the hardcover is in previews right now. And if you do not pre-order, I got some horrible news. You will not get it, because that is how the comic works. So please tell your retailer, like, no matter, you know, it's one of those books that we've gotten literally like well over 100 positive reviews, but still you can't find the book anywhere because people don't pre-order. So please, please, please pre-order. If you actually like comics that are not like everyone else's comics and you want something different, you have to support it. Otherwise, they won't exist.
Excellent. Good,
awesome.
good words of advice, Joshua. Thank you once again for your time. Sarah,
thanks so much, guys,
for bringing this into us.
Yeah.
But I have to say goodbye. We have to keep moving.
Sad. So sad.
Go and start enjoying your weekend,
Sarah.
All
right.
We're going to throw it over to Will and Norm from Tested.
Bye, guys.
They've got some Easter madness. I should also mention, we've got Big Ben intern for the day manning the chat room. We've also got a phone number that you can call if you want to call in and ask any of our panel of experts questions. The number is 415-508-3975. If you are on Skype, the name is Whiskey Media. There it is again, 415-508-3975, Whiskey Media on Skype. Will and Norm, let's go.
Hey guys, it's Will from Tested.
Norm from Tested, thanks Ryan.
It's Easter this
Easter
weekend.
Easter Sunday. I love Easter. It's the best holiday because I'm also from the Far East.
Okay, I like Easter because of the bunnies and the candy is terrible. Universally bad.
We like the bunnies.
Always gross.
We don't like the candy.
Love the bunnies, hate the candy. So naturally what we've done is set up another one of our, you know, famous tests where we test
bunnies.
No, that would be awesome.
Man.
And also probably against the law. We're going to test different kinds of Easter candy.
Woo! My tongue is not like this.
And of course, the blindfolds are going to make an appearance.
The famous blindfolds.
What we're going to do, we're going to do the identification challenge again. Last time, if I recall correctly, I came in with a triumphant victory right at the end.
I think it was some sort of mistrial.
Right. Today,
controversy.
Today we have 15 different kinds of Easter candy prepared by Dan Meisner. We have Jeff here to keep score, because we realized last time that not having someone keeping score probably was a mistake.
I am the off-camera eyes that will keep you honest.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes, that's creepy.
Let's give the viewers a little preview of what kind. Yeah. You bought the Easter candy.
I bought a bunch of candy.
All right.
So we have
traditionally, there's the Cadbury.
Well, there's two types.
Egg.
Well, three types, really. There's chocolate candy, there's marshmallow candy, and then there's jelly beans. Those are the three Easter candies, at least in my household growing up.
And
we have representatives of all three.
That's
the gooey. We have two types of gooey, gross eggs So what we did was Dan was kind enough to mash them up with a knife earlier today.
So we can't even
identify based on texture.
That was how I was gonna win.
Yeah, I know.
And like, this is a peep head. You can get the eyeball.
So I think we should jump right to this. It's time. Don your blindfolds.
All right, blindfolds on, gentlemen.
Let me take off my glasses.
I'm watching. Blindfolds on.
The secrets to my chasing power.
I'm watching to make sure he actually puts it on. Does we all know Norm? Norm is how you spell winning. Okay.
I got the blindfold on.
Vinny, you got the answers coming to my ear, right?
Oh, okay.
All right.
I put the ear off.
Covers off.
What am I doing?
We put on our right and left hands, respectively. You should get a sample. Jeff, can you tell us when to go, please?
Yes.
Taste this.
Now is the time to
go. 3, 2, 1, go.
Reese's.
Peanut butter egg.
Will.
What?
He said peanut butter egg. All you said was Reese's. That was
Reese's what?
All right, you both have two. Ready to go? Ready, 3, 2, 1, eat.
Crunchy. Also,
Cadbury mini egg, milk chocolate.
Will.
Wow.
What the fuck?
2 for 2.
It all tastes the same.
Hold on.
This is what you get for numbing up your tongue.
Cleansing palate.
Cleansing palate. Hold. Hold. Number 3.
Wait. Will. Give Norm a chance to palate cleanse here.
I've got a lot of chocolate wedged into my back teeth.
All right. Glass up. 3, 2, 1, eat.
Oh my god.
Kind of tastes like nerds. Jelly beans.
Jelly bellies.
Watermelon jelly beans.
Will.
Jesus. Norm, he's killing you here.
I didn't buy the candy. I have no idea what candy is in here.
You had an opportunity to study, Tim. Oh my god.
Sunnies for chumps.
Cups ready. 3, 2, 1, eat.
Oh.
Oh, is that like. It tastes like jelly beans and chocolate.
There's another flavor. Endless.
Do you have an answer? Three.
I'm gonna say.
One.
Crackle.
No answer.
Nope. Not crunch.
No answer.
No crunch.
Do we get to hear what it was?
We should hear what it was.
Little Beauties.
What the hell is little beauty?
Isn't that like some sort of 70s barbiturate?
Yes.
Nice.
Number 5. Cups up. 3, 2, 1. Eat.
Oh, you're stuck in a cup.
Oh, it's some marshmallow thing.
Peep.
It's a peep.
Peep.
It's an orange peep. It's a pink peep.
Pink.
It's a yellow peep.
Oh,
it's the little bunny marshmallow things. I don't remember what they're called.
All right. Got 3.
Chicks and rabbits.
2.
Oh my god,
1,
this is horrible.
Nothing. All right. That is buttered popcorn and pink peep.
Knowing what it is lets me taste the flavor. And
yeah, I got that good. Well, the buttered popcorn.
Water
is
break. That goes beyond backwash, Norm, and into the realm of you spit into your water cup.
I need a place to spit it out.
That's fine. Number 6.
I'm chewing the buttered popcorn.
Cups up. 3, 2, 1, eat.
Oh my god.
More jelly beans.
These are sour jelly beans from Jelly Belly.
Go on.
Licorice jelly beans.
I can't.
I need more.
It's it tastes like pink.
Show me pink.
The singer?
No.
Okay. All right, then
it's
you're still
cherry,
wrong.
It's cherry, maybe?
It does not say cherry maybe on this sheet.
Is it a cherry Jelly Belly jelly bean?
3.
Wild
two,
cherry?
1.
What
berry cherry green apple.
It's not green apple at all.
There's no green apple. It's just cherry. This one feels very light.
7. Cups up.
I'm still chewing the last 4 things. Chocolate and jelly beans does not go well together.
3, 2, 1, eat.
Oh, yuck. Oh, this is
a
crunch egg.
Come on!
No.
Oh,
keep going.
No, wait. Keep
Malden
going.
Milk balls. These are Robin's eggs.
No.
Oh.
3, 2, 1. Whoppers.
There were Whoppers.
I did not know what a Whopper tastes like.
I didn't buy any Whoppers. This whole thing is rigged.
Those aren't Whoppers.
I hope they're Whoppers.
All right. Number 8. 3, 2, 1. Eat.
Oh. Foul.
More peeps. No,
this is that marshmallow bunny thing. I don't know what they're called, though.
Brock's chicks and rabbits.
Yes.
No!
Yeah! All right! Norm Chan!
I have here chicks and rabbits, and then in parentheses, banana? With a question mark.
Yeah, banana question mark is exactly the flavor as I would describe it.
I wasn't sure.
All banana-flavored things should be labeled as banana?
Number 9. 3, 2, 1, eat.
Nothing.
If you can.
You get your tongue in there. Come on.
Get it in you.
Don't be shy.
It's a Cadbury cream egg.
No, I will. Yes.
All right. We're going to take a a break here for a second from the taste testing. We have a call. Rob from London on the line. Rob, are you there?
Water break, go.
Break here for a second from the taste testing. We have a call.
Rob, you gotta turn down your radio, man.
Water break, go.
Oh my god.
Come on.
Rob, you there? You getting anything? All right.
Do we have to taste more?
You know what? Maybe drink some water there. How's the experience going for you guys so far?
It's pretty horrible.
Yeah.
You know how you said we shouldn't do any more food segments?
Oh, wait. Yeah, actually, I do.
You
pretty
still
clearly.
Were wrong.
Uh-huh.
This is what a blind child feels like at the local Easter,
Dan,
summer Easter
Norman.
Party.
I don't think he can reach his glass
without
knocking it over.
We have to find buddies now? Where are the eggs?
That's not water anymore, man.
Oh, man. Is Norman right. spitting into his glass
All right,
again?
We're
Cup
gonna,
10.
We're just going to go on to the next
one
here.
More?
Three, two, one, eat.
Oh, gotta right. get your tongue in there.
it's all the cream.
Come on.
Come on.
Who has an answer?
Oh, it's sour. It's gonna be Jelly Belly sours.
No, not, definitely not jelly beans.
No.
I don't know what those things taste like. Oh, this is horrible.
It's some type of like lemon pie thing.
Three, two, one. Tabasco pepper jelly.
You guys are oh,
man. Animated GIF coming right up.
Oh.
I'm like gonna take full
it.
Credit for that one.
All right, number 11.
Why did you have Tabasco jelly? That was
Three,
wrong with you people.
2, 1, 11.
Peep. Yellow.
Pink.
Orange, red.
Red, green, blue, purple pepper.
That is Norm.
Yay!
Purple
right.
Yes!
We now actually have Rob from London on the line. We've worked out our technical issues. Rob?
These are horrible.
Hello.
Rob, do you have a question for the tested men?
Yes, I do. Basically, right, you're eating Easter eggs. Oh, yeah, I see.
Basically, you were eating Easter eggs.
UK, we should
have had an Easter egg eating contest.
Easter eggs, like, I saw, like, they started selling them, like, back in January. Like, isn't that, like, totally crazy? And I don't know why they do it, but they just been selling them since January. What are your thoughts on this sort of madness?
I think it's part of the problem.
Rob, thanks for calling. So the increasingly early release of holiday goods in the stores.
That's why they taste so bad. They're all expired.
Right.
They've been sitting around for too long. They've been there since basically, you know,
Valentine's Day.
Well,
right?
It's like those people who put up the Christmas decorations and never take them down.
Yeah.
By the time we reach August, it's too late. You might as well keep it up
Christmas
for the rest
lights
of the year.
Above your desk right now, Norm?
Yep.
Well, that's neither here nor there. All right, let's get on to the testing.
Number 12.
Four more. Oh, good grief.
Ready. 3, 2, 1, eat.
I enjoy watching them try to
use look, jelly beans.
Yes.
All of their senses.
Oh,
Will.
Oh, God. I'm not gonna, there's no way we're gonna get the rest of anything.
Oh,
no.
Oh, God damn it.
What
I don't wanna eat that.
Number 13.
It's too much punishment for my tongue.
Lucky 13.
My God. Licorice tastes horrible. Why does anybody like to eat this?
It's disgusting. 3, 2, 1, eat.
Oh. Robin's eggs.
Jelly bean.
No.
Go on.
Did you give us different stuff? Because mine was clearly chocolate that was malted.
Mine clearly is some type of jelly.
Yeah?
Coconut jelly bean.
Uh-huh. That's, you guys are both right there.
Coconut jelly bean, come on, give me some flakes.
Pink Robin's eggs, blue Robin's eggs, yellow Robin's eggs.
It is Whoppers, Robin eggs, and coconut.
You people are monsters.
14.
Ryan? Not having studied for the test, I feel really. It's my.
Have you gotten any right yet, Chan?
He did.
Oh, okay, that's nice.
Though he's mathematical. Let's just say he's mathematically eliminated.
He's eliminated
at this point. So just go for glory at this point.
I'm just gonna stop then.
Number 14. Okay. 3, 2, 1, go.
Oh.
Nestle Crunch. Egg.
Yes.
Oh, hey, congratulations, Norm. You got one.
Norm.
I'll give these last few to you.
All right, is this our final one?
This is the final. This one is worth double.
It weighs twice as much as the other
one. This one is worth 100 points.
This one is worth 1,000 points.
Thus rendering the previous competition irrelevant.
I'm not gonna. 3, 2, 1, go!
Oh. It's salted caramel eggs.
Yes!
Wow. Correct! And Will Smith takes it!
Wow. This looks like it looks like crap!
You can say
I think I would have rather eaten crap than that one, actually.
Why were you looking at it?
That is six. That is 6-3 Will on the natural scale, but the 100 points that we get
for 15 is 1 million to 3. Yes, thanks, guys. Wow, that is super gross.
I would not put this in my mouth.
I wish I
had.
You know what?
You did put it in your mouth.
It tastes very salty.
That's because we poured a bunch of salt into it.
Thanks a lot.
That's Will and Norm from Testing. Thank you guys so much.
Happy Easter, guys.
Yeah, have a good Easter, guys.
Happy Easter to all of you and yours. I'm joined here now on the couch. Alex Trevorrow and Matt Rory from Screen.com. Gentlemen, what's going on? Get the pound. There it is. The pound that I like. Let's talk movies. Leave the caressing for later. I should say, we are going to be doing some trivia here in a minute. So if you think you know your movie quotes, we're going to be giving out some audio clips earlier. We're going to have you complete them. We've got prizes galore here just off camera that we're going to be giving out for those.
Myriad
so if you think you have what it takes, 415-508-3975. If you're on Skype, Whiskey Media is the number.
Show us what you got.
Let's start things off with Rio.
Okay.
All right.
This will be a short one.
Her name is Rio.
No.
And she dances on the sand.
None of that is true in the case of this film. Makers of Ice Age.
New animated film from 20th Century Fox. I think we have a trailer of that. Let's roll it and talk a little bit about this.
Yes, let's talk a very little bit about it.
There's no way this is just a film, though. They are trying to make a new franchise. Did you get that sense from it?
Oh, yeah.
The Ice Age movies make like $800 million each time they
The last one made $300 million, and it was, like the laziest thing ever.
But I mean, worldwide, they make $1 billion.
Yeah.
Fucking bizarre.
And this seems destined to, open with like $40-45 million, easy.
So, Jesse Eisenberg as this Minnesota-bound parrot.
Super domesticated wild bird.
Is he neurotic at all?
Oh, yes.
Does he stutter awkwardly through conversation?
Perhaps a bit nebbish.
Okay.
Yeah. And so they they got to bring him down to Brazil.
Does he start a very influential internet company from his dorm room with some friends and then screw them all over in a weird turn of megalomaniacal.
God, that would have been so much better a movie.
Social Network with parrots. I'm selling it.
No,
Hollywood, call me.
Whole movie is about fucking. It's rated PG, and it's about two birds having to get together to save their species. But then there's also, like crazy poachers, and Will I Am and Jamie Foxx play crazy Brazilian birds that sing a lot with auto-tune.
I'll be in my bunk.
Yeah, it's fine. It's one of the more generic animated movies I've seen in a while. But it's also reasonably funny at times. It's very colorful. The way I put it in my review is someday there will be a Smithsonian exhibit, or like a National Film Archive exhibit of like what early 2000s animated children's films looked like. And that will be the central example because it hits like every cliche, every beat that you've already seen, like every other movie
Do we get the DreamWorks smirk out of anyone?
No, because it's Fox, and they don't do the DreamWorks face. But there is a lot of like googly-eyed, crazy faces because they're cartoon characters.
But keep in mind, we're in the middle of spring break. Yeah. This is a time that a bunch of kids are going to go see some damn movies. You're coming up on Easter as it is.
You're digging out of the snow. You want to see something cold.
It's boilerplate, but it's also not bereft of fun.
Yeah.
I would say if you go to a $6 matinee and don't see it in 3D, it's worth that. It's worth that kind of money.
But just like competently animated, I feel like
it looks
to the point
good.
Where
yeah.
pretty much everything that's a big studio CG animated thing at least looks good.
It's like being cudgeled by a pipe wrench that's rainbow colored.
Fantastic. Let's move on. Let's go to the other end of the spectrum, Matt Rory.
Something else entirely.
Wes Craven's self-aware slasher series.
I was kind of surprised how this movie turned out.
After a decade absence.
Yeah. Yeah.
So Scream 4 is basically a remake of Scream 1, but except talking about other horror movies, it talks about the Scream franchise, which is the most audaciously weird thing to make a movie out of. But
it also makes complete sense for Scream, because like the series has been getting more and more self-referential.
Like, where else do you go?
Yeah.
You can go like the fourth wall. So what your suggestion was, you have to like have Wes Craven in Scream 4. If you want to get any crazier than Scream 3, that is the ultimate end. So basically, high school students, Ghostface killing them, but they also have Sydney and Gale and Dewey kind of as, not even the Greek chorus, they're participants in activities that they had, in 1995
but with these high school kids also along for the ride. So it's like two movies sort of like smushing into each other at a certain point.
So are they like trying to give like salient advice to these younger characters that are going through this again?
And like Hayden Panettiere is basically Rose McGowan from the first film. Emma Roberts is basically Sydney from the first film. They have, you know, the nerdy high school kid who knows all about the art movie trivia. It's really weird. It's pretty effective as a slasher film, but after, if you reference, it makes so many references to Scream 1. If you're putting yourself in a position to compare yourself to Scream 1, you have to really deliver the goods. And it kind of doesn't really push it as far as it could. Kevin Williamson really kind of famously kind of kicked off during the middle or right before they started filming this, and they replaced him with a guy from Scream 3.
Kind of the screenwriter of the first two films.
The first two.
One of the big creative forces.
And then the Scream 3 was written by somebody else and was kind of a notoriously kind of crappy third movie in the trilogy.
So what do you think this says for my much-wanted Faculty sequel? Is it time for that yet?
It probably didn't fucking reboot.
It would be a remake at this point.
So usually you add the to the front of it, but since it's already the Faculty, do you just call it Faculty?
The faculty.
You go the other way?
The new beginning.
How many? I got a video. I'm curious to see how many puppies show up in this video. Why don't we start it from the beginning of my video, my puppy video, and see how many puppies show up here? How about that?
Well, I see one puppy.
How many puppies are I giving to?
Do you think it's? Oh, it's two. It's at least two puppies.
Two puppies.
This is at least two puppies.
Is that it? Two puppies.
Is it only a two puppy movie?
Three puppies.
Third puppy.
Three puppies on a treadmill. That's the essence of Scream.
Yeah.
Basically, it's Scream 4, three puppies on a treadmill. Really.
So we've just completely undercut it. People don't want to see Scream 4 now. They've seen three puppies on a treadmill.
That's all they need.
What's the point?
Four reviews of both these films.
Yes.
And a billion trailers have come out over the last 2 days. So there's like a new trailer
That's a big number.
Rise of the Planet of the Apes.
I think you're using hyperbole.
Yeah, maybe a little.
I'm just going to throw it out there.
I'm exaggerating the microphone.
Worth noting.
I think you're literally using hyperbole.
Wow. This weekend, I will also be partaking of Atlas Shrugged Part 1, possibly in an intoxicated state. We will see how that goes.
5% on Rotten Tomatoes.
Oh, yeah. Man.
So awesome. Good. So stoked about that.
It's, you know, it's animatronics acting out Ayn Rand, so I'm totally into it.
I hope this scares anyone away from trying to make a Rand into a movie for at least the next, like, 15 to 20 years.
I mean, this feels like it's going to be one of those, like, you know, Buckaroo Banzai moments of it says part one, but clearly there's never going to be another movie made based on this. I'm open for that.
All right, so those are the new movies. We got a bunch of trailers up on the site.
Yeah, a million trailers.
A billion trailers.
A gajillion D.
A sextillion trailers.
See, at least that's a made-up number.
Yeah.
So I can roll with it. I can say, okay, well, that could be accurate. Let's start getting into some trivia, you
sure.
guys.
We need a caller. If we don't have a caller,
I don't believe we have a caller yet. But I can help warm it up. I'm happy to do this. I think I know a thing or two.
We're throwing
about
them out at random. We changed up the rules a little bit. I'll tell you, there's not going to be easy hard. We're just going to do them. Two out of three gets a prize.
Just going to do it to it.
If you want a chance to try this out, we're gonna do a round here in the studio. You can see how it works. 415-508-3975 is the number.
And we do.
If you're on Skype, it's Whiskey Media. Give us a call, and we'll get you on the air here. And we've got copies of Scream.
Scream,
we've got a bunch of crazy movie posters giveaway. We've got film strips. We have hardcore pornography. Anything you could possibly imagine. Wait. I was wrong about that last part. We don't have hardcore pornography, but everything else we've got here. So let's do our first audio trivia.
Ryan Davis, why don't you do a line?
Oh, yeah.
Right here on camera?
Vinny, give him a line.
Someone roll up a 20. All right, let's hear the line, if we can. Is there anything else going on with you guys?
So, Cowboys and Aliens had a new trailer. There's a trailer for Rise of the Planet of the Apes.
Oh, I'm sorry. I think we've confused the room back there. If we've got a call already, we could do that. Otherwise, all right, we're just going to go right into
college.
We've got Phil from Woodstock.
Man, I wanted to see how good you were.
We'll still have a chance for that. Phil from Woodstock, are you there?
Phil from Woodstock.
I am here, Ryan Davis.
Phil from Woodstock. Are you ready for your movie trivia challenge with Scream?
I am ready. I just want to say goodbye to Alex.
Oh.
We never discussed that. You weren't even here in the screening room. Alex
no,
is
I wasn't.
Leaving us for New York.
That's true.
I'm not leaving Whiskey Media.
He's not.
Yeah, no. He'll still be around. But all right, sir, are you ready for your first trivia challenge?
I am ready. Ryan Davis, I love you.
Oh, thank you, sir.
Phil, you get 2 out of 3. You get a big prize. You get 3 out of 3. You get a poster. How about that?
I love it. I can't wait to see it, Rory.
All right, let's do it.
Are you ready to take Woodstock?
Woodstock, New Brunswick. Let's do it.
What does that mean? New Brunswick.
Bowling.
Yes.
It's right by Maine. It's right by Maine.
You're by Maine.
Discovered by the Germans in 1904. They named it.
It's in Canada.
San Diego.
Are you hearing anything, Phil?
Which, of course,
I can hear
in
you.
German.
Can you hear me?
Can you hear the quote? Are you hearing the movie quote, Phil?
I can't hear it.
Okay.
Okay. Neither can we, really.
A little more volume on the movie quote. Would be great.
It's a fact. It's the greatest city in the history of mankind. Discovered by the Germans in 1904, they named it San Diego, which, of course, in German means...
Did you hear that, Phil?
I heard it. Sound like Will Ferrell.
Did you get audible thing? Can you complete the quote from that?
Will Ferrell, Anchorman.
Well, you got to complete the actual quote, not just the movie. I don't know if you did. You hear?
Oh, sorry, sorry. I can't hear it, Rory. I'm sorry.
It's a technical. So, Cowboys and Aliens. That new trailer was really actually pretty exciting. It was
really because the first one looked awful.
It's a weird film. I don't know where they're gonna go with it. It looks like they need a little bit more humor, in my opinion.
There's huge amount of talent associated with it, but I
love Jon Favreau.
I can't tell. We're gonna try this.
We're gonna try this again.
Phil, are you there?
I'm here. I'm still here, guys. Sorry, I don't want to let you down.
We're gonna play a clip. And then we're going to need you to say the next line after the clip ends, okay?
I'm with you.
All right, here we go. Here's the clip.
It's the greatest city in the history of mankind. Discovered by the Germans in 1904, they named it San Diego. Which, of course, in German means...
Which, of course, in German means...
Ah, say sexy San Diego.
Oh,
no.
Let's say it all together.
Whale's vagina.
Everyone knows that's what San Diego means in German. Phil.
Phil, you're down one, but he gets two more chances.
He gets two more chances.
Oh, awesome. Well, one more chance, and then if he fails at that one, then okay. He's off.
He's got one more guaranteed chance here.
One more guaranteed chance.
I will wait till we are ready with the clip loaded up, and then let's go. Clip is ready. Phil, are you ready?
I am ready.
Clip number two, let's hear it.
Say, man, you got a joint? No, not on me, man.
Dazed and confused.
Dazed and confused. You got any papers?
No. Oh.
Be a lot cooler
Terrible.
If you did.
Be a lot cooler if you did. That was a tough one. If you haven't seen Dazed and Confused, that's not exactly a famous movie line. But
it's I think it's up there. Phil, I'm sorry. You struck out twice.
It's okay, guys. In Canada, we don't have a lot of movie theaters, and it's hard to see movies.
Phil, PM me on screen. My name is Rory. I'll send you a little film strip or something like that for playing along,
Rory,
being a good sport.
Thanks,
you don't
buddy.
Want to ship to Canada.
Whiskey Media, love you guys.
Love all right, thank you, Phil, for your call. I think we've worked out the kinks. We can move on here. Keep calling in if you want to participate. You want prizes, 415-508-3975 or Whiskey Media on Skype.
Do you want to try one?
Yeah, let's see if I can try one.
All right.
I don't know if we're ready for that or if we can go on to our next call. I will wait Either for way. The word from our magicians behind the scenes.
Go on. Hit up the chat, maybe see what they're saying. Any questions for the chat?
Ben, anything cool happening in the chat in the meantime?
Question for Rory. Sean Case wants to know if you were surprised by the ending of Scream.
Sean Case?
Scam Case.
Surprised by the ending of Scream 4?
Yes.
Can't spoil it.
I don't think I want you to answer that.
Actually, that's a good point because I did have a predictions thread on screen this week and I didn't make predictions. So if I said I was surprised or not surprised, people could possibly even
you know
be spoiled
what?
By that.
So. Let me just put it this way. Did you like the ending of the film?
Yes.
Okay. Done.
That's good. The middle part of this film is very cut and dry slasher movie. The beginning is really clever and funny.
Yeah.
And then it goes on. Here's a bunch of young teenage girls getting horribly murdered, and then it has the
That's
ending.
Hot.
The ending, which is kind of ramped up from the original Scream ending. So it's a good little... The middle of the film is the weakest part.
That's really hot.
I said, I might actually have to try and catch that this weekend.
If you're a Scream fan, you're going to enjoy it.
Yeah.
No doubt.
If only they transposed Atlas Shrugged and Scream into the same thing.
Scream Shrugged? Atlas Shrugged?
I would say Atlas Shrugged, more of a horror
Atlas
movie.
Screamed?
And less self-aware.
Yeah.
On both counts.
Daggy Taggart getting stabbed.
Finally!
Yes. And it was all John Galt.
Man. I would rather see... Well,
John Gosses.
I'm not going to get into it.
Yeah.
He'd get upset Randians. It gets...
They'll write
They're harmless.
They'll write your letters. Don't give you
calls. They will write strongly worded, very long letters. Anything else from the chat, Ben?
Yeah, the chat wants to know if you guys are looking forward to Cars 2, our only Pixar film this year.
Thoughts on Cars 2?
Looking forward to, no.
You know, the odd thing is they have an Incredibles Facebook page, which I'm a fan of, and they constantly update it with movie quotes and stuff. And I'm curious if they're obviously trying to, they came out on Blu-ray last week.
Yep.
I'm curious if they're trying to keep it alive for maybe
down the road.
Some kind of Incredibles 2. I would be totally excited for Incredibles 2.
Craig T. Nelson is only going to be alive for so long. That's all I'm saying.
I'm in the minority in that I
you think Incredibles stands on
it? No. In that I enjoyed the original Cars. I know it's largely shunned. It's largely considered their weakest, but I thought it was fine.
It's better than Ice Age, you know.
People didn't care for some of the concepts, but it did, you know, it was their most popular. It makes sense for it to be the first one that they they sequelized.
They have made literally billions of dollars off of the merchandising, so. Hey Disney! All of a sudden, we bought Pixar. We're gonna
make some money.
We've got another caller.
I'm ready.
Yes.
Hi.
Hello. How's it going?
Who is this, sir? What's your name?
Matthew from Reno.
From Reno. How's it going? You're here with Matt and Alex from Screened. Are you ready for your audio movie trivia challenge?
Most definitely. Let's do this.
All right.
Fantastic.
Make a crowd, Matthew. Let's hit him with it.
Our clip queued up, and we will roll it when ready.
Lawrence. What would you do if you had $1 million?
I'll tell you what I'd do, man.
Office Space, complete the quote.
I'm sorry, you're going to have to play the clip again.
Oh, I couldn't quite hear it. Can we turn up the clip a little bit this time?
He's Googling it right now.
Yeah, I'm sorry, you get the one shot at it. Do you have it or not?
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear it. My bad.
The answer is two chicks at the same time.
Indeed. That is never not the answer.
Quote from Office Space.
Strike one.
Let's see if you can redeem yourself on the second quote. Are you ready, Matt?
Let's roll.
All right, let's hear it.
I didn't know you could fly a plane.
Why, yes!
Land and no.
Yes!
Yeah! Finally a winner.
All right.
Big winner. You get one more chance.
One in. Now you could potentially win yourself a digital versatile disc. By answering
direct visual digital,
by completing this next movie quote correctly.
I have never been so excited in my entire life.
No one wants to sit on this couch after Matt Rohrer, believe me. Let's get that next quote.
I'm sitting next.
It can't be.
What is it?
It can't be.
What did you do, Ray? Oh, shit.
I forgot how long that was.
Oh my God!
No. Goodbye, Matthew. You had a good shot there.
Can we play the actual clip at the end of that, Vinny? If there's possible. If not, we'll just say it.
It's the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man.
It is the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man.
Thanks a lot, guys.
Matt, good try.
PM me on screen.
Better luck next time.
I gotta make these easier. I don't know.
Yeah, that is easy.
That is a super easy one.
I mean, let's throw me one more here in the studio because I so far have been able to ace all of these. All
right, Ryan wants one.
Give me one here in the studio.
Let me tell you something, Pandeo. You pull any of your crazy shit with us, you flash a piece out on the lane. I'll take it away from you and stick it up your ass and pull the fucking trigger.
Until it goes click.
Indeed.
Jesus.
That's right, man. Nobody fucks with the Jesus.
8-year-olds.
That's how you play the game!
We complete the quote way further than it even should be.
We've run out of time for Screen, so no prizes this
week.
We're continuing to streamline the process.
I got Polish people. Come on!
We're gonna try this again next week. We're gonna streamline the process and continue to try and give you guys the wonderful prizes that you all deserve. Alex and Matt, you're not going anywhere for this next segment.
We're done talking
about movies, but we are talking about something that was tangentially related to movies.
Perhaps a movie I reviewed last year.
It's time for video games, folks. It's time for Giant Bomb. Get that box out of the way.
Oh, okay.
Move it.
Next week, there are a ton of very exciting new releases happening.
perhaps the most in quite a while.
Certainly the most here. This year.
And I think I speak for all of us when I say that none has us more on the edge of our seats than the Prince of Persia HD collection for the PlayStation 3.
Yes!
That's right, the Prince of Persia Sands of Time game, Prince of Persia Sands of Time, Warrior Within, and the Two Thrones, all in one package. Now, we've got this here. We're actually looking at the menu screen right now. When you first load the game up, this is what it looks like. You can just choose one of these three. Now, these games were actually released separately on the PlayStation Network right. a while ago, but now they're putting them together in this full package. They've up-res stuff. They've cleaned up textures and stuff, or at least that's their claim. This is literally my first time booting this up, so...
So we're going to discover this together.
We're going to see what this looks like, and joining us for this discoverous adventure is none other than the Giant Bomb's Brad Shoemaker.
Would you call it a voyage of discovery?
Sure.
All right. I'm down for it.
Do you like voyages?
Always down for a voyage.
Voyages.
Fantastic. Are you down for voyages of loading screens?
Sure. Well, and
video. I'm big on Bink Video.
Bink. What a great name for a codec.
Bink. Hey. What up, the Sands of Time?
So,
I like this game.
So this is, we are looking at Prince of Persia, the Sands of Time
Pretty.
Right now.
They didn't up-res that logo.
I don't know the exact name of the collection. Prince of Persia, HD, PS3.
Pop Hood.
Give me the
Prince of Persia trilogy.
Prince of Persia trilogy is what the spine says. Yeah.
Prince of Persia trilogy. All
we're
right,
we're so
it's,
that,
it's just like Mortal Kombat trilogy.
What are my extra features making of? This actually has a pretty good making of, if I recall.
I think they all did.
Jordan Mechner was pretty involved in the making of this original Sands of Time game. Yeah.
But then he wrote the movie too. So what does that really?
Oh come on!
I'm joking.
That movie was kind of fun.
He had his moments.
He did what he had to bring that into a film format.
I liked it enough.
And immediately goes from menu, and I am now controlling the prince here.
Nice.
I remember a pretty lengthy cutscene at the beginning of this. We might be treated to...
Oh,
skip
hey,
guess what?
Yeah.
Skip
We're
it.
We're going to skip it.
I just hit X.
Wow, they did not do a great job of that model.
Well,
I mean it's,
forget, this, dude, forget. It's an
this
Xbox
is, this
game.
This is like a 10-year-old
game. Yeah, put this into historical context. I think it was
2004,
I'm almost positive.
I'm going to say 3.
Okay. I'm going to go with 3, because I was going to say 2, but that's too early.
I don't know, I would expect... Oh my god, look at those arms.
But this has been proper high-defified, right?
Yeah, like this has been definitely
like
up-res.
720p, yeah. It looks like. Look like proper widescreen and everything.
Seems to be moving pretty good.
Yeah.
I'm going to jump up here.
If you don't get 60 FPS in this, you're doing something really
and,
fucking wrong.
And you know what? Plenty of people who have tried to, you know, put games like this out have done it wrong, so
if,
I'm just
if
saying.
If you've never seen The Sands of Time before, though, this is arguably a pretty influential game for modern action games.
This game was a watershed moment for this style of game.
Just the cinematic, like those cuts that you're seeing like that, the way the camera is kind of intelligently guiding you along. Like, you take this stuff for granted these days, but you didn't see anything quite like this before.
Assassin's Creed would not be around if it weren't for these games.
Oh, yeah. Assassin's Creed is directly...
The acrobatics in this are really, at the time, it was like nothing you've ever played before.
There are countless games use this specific style of kind of traversal now, you know, climbing on ledges and wall running and all that stuff.
It is sort of weird to be talking about this game as like a seminal work because it doesn't actually feel like it was that long ago that it came out.
We were all working in this industry when this came out.
I know, like I was reviewing games for a living when this game came out, and that doesn't feel that long ago.
I think I did a game guide for this for somebody. God.
Oh, there we go.
No, I think it was for us.
It might have been, I'm not sure. Somebody Google that.
No. Oh, find it! There we go.
You were just here before.
Yeah, you just totally went back.
No, I did this from the other side.
Okay.
You're the other side.
Oh, jumping off that incorrectly.
Whatever.
There we go. No.
So there's there's the other part of this game.
There it is. Okay.
There you go.
I was jumping when I didn't need to.
Again, the little ledge traversal. That's God of War as well. I mean, God of War came out after this, I believe.
Oh, yeah. A couple years after.
A lot of
this
stuff that the traversal stuff in God of War was probably my least favorite part of that game.
But the cinematic cutaways was something they definitely employed a lot.
I did just make a. Yeah. Okay, I need to. There we go.
You should.
That's what I was trying to do. Okay.
You should stab this guy.
Oh, I'm gonna mess this dude up. That's maybe the weak part of this game was the combat was not the best, but it was dynamic, and it moved quickly.
They improved a lot of the second two games as well.
It was really the only part they improved.
I remember that. I like the third one. The third one was.
Third one was okay. The second one I never even finished. It was just too.
That was one I never made fun of.
I never even started it. It was a little too much guy liner for me.
It was gritty.
Yeah, no, that was...
Look at this!
Bye!
god!
That was when the prince got way into Godsmack.
I like how the dude's just taking a knee, like, oh, man, I'm
just
tired.
Enough! Now you're tired forever.
Huh?
Ben, if we've got any questions from the chat or if we have any phone calls, please feel free to send them our way.
We want to know what the people want to know about the biggest game of next week.
You really like that pool.
Paul. People want to know if we are going to ever see a sequel to the 2008 Prince of Persia.
We asked that same question of some guys who would know at Ubisoft last year, and they kind of implied maybe we would.
I thought they were going to go back to this style, though.
They did, so...
Yeah, they did Forgotten Sands, right?
They did 2008 Prince of Persia, which was a complete departure, and then they did Forgotten Sands last year, which was a continuation of this stuff, but also seemed like it existed because there was a movie coming out.
Yeah.
Because it was only okay. But yeah, it sounds like, if nothing else, they would like to do more with that universe.
That 2008 game is amazingly beautiful, but impossible to lose.
Fantastic art design. I thought the spawn mechanic was great.
It was really fun, but was like basically impossible to lose.
Well, yeah, you know, you would. It's just that it checkpointed you every 10 seconds.
Yeah. I don't mind games that, you know, are willing to make it relatively easy to progress, but that game was even like a little far, I think, in that direction.
This is like the dragon jump in Ninja Gaiden, where you can do it every time the jump over and rotate, heads popping off left and right.
Oh, well, you know, this predates that.
Yeah, oh, Ninja Gaiden, totally influenced by Prince of Persia.
This sort of action here. Let's, you know, we've seen a little bit of this here. Do we want to go
on to
actually
being facetious, but it's actually not too far off, like Ninja Gaiden, the Xbox One, in terms of the camera system and the wall jumping.
Network. Oh, look at that.
That's some wall running.
All right, I'm going to do this, and we've got Michael from the UK on the line. He's going to ask questions. Michael, you there?
Hiya.
What are your questions about Prince of Persia, sir?
I was just wondering whether, you know, well, it's not actually about Prince of Persia. I was wondering about the Wii 2, whether, you know, what we've heard about it and, you know, if we were going to see it at E3. I mean, you know, there seems to be a lot of hoo-ha about it, and, you know, I was just wondering what you guys thought.
Are you referring to the H-Wii?
Michael, thanks for your call. You know as much as we do.
Yeah.
You know, we have no inside line on that stuff.
I mean, the only thing I'll say
is... And if we did, we couldn't tell you.
Yeah, the only thing
I'll say...
Well, that's the thing, is that apparently everyone now has an inside line as of yesterday.
Right.
It's like, as soon as Game Informer was like, yeah, this is happening, then everyone got their own inside sources and was like, well, I heard this, well, I heard this, well, we're doing this.
I mean, it's entirely plausible, you know? Wii hardware sales have been dropping off for a while. Third-party support is drying up by the day.
At some point, where there's smoke... There's fire.
And really, the discrepancy between what the Wii could do and what the PS3 and 360 could do was only becoming more and more apparent,
yeah.
becoming more and more of an issue.
Yeah.
Especially for third-party people.
For third parties.
Yeah. I mean, if you have to do the entire game over to port it, then and you're only going to sell a tenth of what you're going to sell on the Xbox, then why bother?
It's anyone's guess, but, you know, hey, maybe there'll be something.
So you can't go back to the main menu?
Yeah, it's kind of a bummer.
Wow. Kind of silly. So
there's got to be a way.
There's got to be a better way.
Jonas Susan wants to know, what other games do you want to see get the HD treatment?
Shadow of Colossus.
Well, that's coming, isn't it?
Is it?
Ubisoft's also doing some past Splinter Cell games the same way. This package is very representative of how they're going to be handling those games.
So this actually came out on PSN in Europe?
Yeah, this has been out as a downloadable for a while.
I think these were actually piecemeal on European PSN.
Yes, yeah, you didn't get the entire thing. You got them one at a time, but this is the full collection.
I'm going
to
say...
So this kind of sucks. I actually have to boot. I have to go all the way out to the cross-media bar, back to the main screen on the PS3.
What up, good UI.
To get back to Ben's question, though, I'm going to say I would love an FF10, FF12 combo pack.
Meh.
Okay.
I like both of those.
I don't know. Any game that old that has a lot of 2D elements is not going to scale.
Yeah, you guys taking questions right now?
What's 3D? New console.
Yeah.
I think 10 was, I think, mostly 3D. I think it still has some static backgrounds.
No, it was all
10? 10 was all polygonal.
Are you thinking of 7 and 8 and 9?
Oh, right. I think they carried that over a little bit, I think.
How about you? What do you want? HD upgrades.
Yeah, I don't know. I was just thinking Ubisoft's been on a tear with this stuff because we did Beyond Good and Evil on the Xbox.
Mm-hmm.
I got this and Splinter Cell coming out.
Yeah, they have the big ass Splinter Cell.
I'm trying to think what else they have from that era.
I mean, the Rayman 3D for the 3DS is kind of an up-res version of, you know, Rayman 2.
Yeah.
Far Cry.
Oh man, so many games.
So many games.
I'm trying to
say Incredible Crisis.
Sure.
There you go.
I'm gonna get mad obscure on you.
Super Mario Galaxy.
Eternal Darkness.
I should also mention that all of these games are playable in three dimensions.
Oh, good.
Oh.
So if you have one of those fancy TVs, here's something to test it out with.
Oh my God. Also, if you have one of those fancy TVs, what are you doing?
And this already, you know what? I think we've gone beyond the point of being able to shun people who have 3D TVs because they're freaking everywhere now.
Are they?
Yeah,
they're getting really.
It's pretty much what you can buy.
Other than Jeff, I know no one who owns one.
I mean, has it reached the point that if you go out to buy a TV, you're just going to end up with one that has 3D?
I don't think we've quite reached that point, but
it's still a little bit of a surcharge. Like I wouldn't get a 3D TV now.
God no.
I would eventually it'll be you're not paying any extra.
And you could already see here, even just from the loading screen, just the complete shift in tone from Sands of Time to Warrior Within, which is what we're loading
Here's
up here now.
He's dripping blood. We have shifted to a Disturbed album cover.
Yeah. And then the prince is all, Why
do I get the feeling that market research informed the change in tone to this game?
I don't see what you're saying at all.
Guys, we want to take another phone call?
Yeah. Because
we have Alan from Stanford online.
Well, if it's Stanford, then no.
Alan!
Yes,
how's
hello.
Stanford?
How's it going?
Pretty good, how's Stanford?
It's great, nice sunny day out here.
Oh, fantastic, you got a question for us here?
I do, so I've never played a Prince of Persia game before.
Any of them?
Is this collection, no, none of them. Is this collection worth checking out for someone who has absolutely no nostalgia for Prince of Persia at all?
Yes.
You know, my only point of contention, I'm not ready to make like full, like yes buy, no avoid recommendations. This is $40 for the trio of games. You could probably get these three games on their own in their original formats for cheaper.
Yeah.
As a combination, but you aren't going to get the HD. You aren't going to get any of the other kind of PS3 bells and whistles.
Yeah, this looks significantly better than those old games.
Yeah, it really does. You're absolutely right. But I still think the original Sands of Time is still a very fun game. And you know, if you care enough about modern video games, this series is. It's important. This is a key evolutionary step in the way modern action games handle.
Yeah, he's flashing back.
Oh, okay. Because he was an alleyway and now it's a boat.
You weren't even listening to me.
I was listening. It's an important benchmark in modern video gaming.
Sir, thank you for your call.
Yes, thank you.
Matt, thanks for nothing.
Thanks for interrupting you, really, is what I do. That's kind of my specialty right here.
Thanks.
So,
thanks.
I'm not sarcastic. It's a speech impediment.
It makes things really hard.
Wait, don't go.
I'm so alone.
And
see.
And there's your 10 seconds of Kids in the Hall references.
Yeah, we don't have to pay for it. We don't do more than that.
Yeah.
But anything else going on in the chat?
Chat wants to know if you want to see an original Prince of Persia remake.
That exists on Xbox Live Arcade. You can download Prince of Persia Classic for, I think, like $10.
I think it's on iPhone, too.
Yeah, I think it's on, well, it's on everything. A billion things now. Yeah.
The fun thing about the original Prince of Persia is that people make extra hard levels, which you can find the repeats on YouTube, and it's like nothing but a dude falling for like 10 minutes straight, trying to get through the first jump and stuff.
Mean-spirited.
Yeah.
That original Prince of Persia is no joke, man.
Yeah, that's, Prince of Persia 2 is really hard.
Here's what I want. We've seen, they've rung Prince of Persia pretty well in the modern
age. Here we go. Finally, the reason to play this game.
She doesn't have like a G-string there, just a butt.
Karateka? Let's bring back Karateka.
This is your Kung Fu.
Or Karateka.
I'm actually thinking about slapping both of you right now.
No, it's another, you know, Jordan Mechner Klasnik. Classic?
Klasnik?
Klasnik.
It's like a beatnik, but classier.
Is that a brand of pickles?
I find this woman's outfit unreasonable.
This is gaming in the 90s summed up in an image.
Early 2000s, really.
When does the new metal kick in?
Kill him. We were already trying to do that, lady. Jeez.
Pretty soon here, I think. I think it's like once you start playing it, the power cords kick up.
And he's dead.
All right, we have show favorite Silver from Wichita, Kansas. Silver! Are you there?
Hi-yo!
Hey, yes, sir.
Never get
tired. How's it going, sir?
Pretty good. So, wondering, in Prince of Persia in general, besides how fun it is to say the Dahaka, what would you feel is the best villain out of the trilogy or even the 2008, either boss fight or villain in general?
The villain inside.
Ben Kingsley.
You know, the vizier is always the most important and...
I like the Shadow Prince.
You can't go wrong with good vizier.
Yeah.
You really can't.
I like the Shadow Prince. I like the evil twin.
Which one was that?
That was three, I believe.
Yeah, that was... Oh, I'm cutting off heads. Just so much more violent. So, everyone turned into sand in the first game when you defeated them. This time, you're beheading dudes, and it's getting real
But they're sand heads, so... Again, that same move, man. It just kills everything.
All right, Silver. Thanks for calling in. Hopefully, we've answered your question for you.
Yes.
You know, I think we are just about out of time for this show, gents. I know it sounds crazy, but this hour has flown by having so much fun.
Indeed.
Yeah, you know what? We've seen what we need to. This is a Prince of Persia Trilogy 3D available next week on the PlayStation 3. It's going to be $40. You can see it next Tuesday in stores. Yeah, Matt, here. There you go. Fooled you. There it is.
He's touching my foot. What's going on here?
That's gonna do, you guys are matching feet. That's nice. Push back. You gotta push back.
This is what it's gonna be like every week.
Oh, you can't even compare.
All right.
Should we give Alex a goodbye? We didn't do one on the on that.
Well, I'm here for a few more weeks.
Yeah,
at least.
Yeah, it's not his last show.
People might not have heard though.
Alex is going to be relocating to the East Coast. He's going to be our New York correspondent for Whiskey Media.
Indeed. At large.
Basically, so we don't have to fly to the East Coast.
And so they don't have to see my ugly face every single day.
The least coast.
No, you mean the beast coast.
I think it's the beast coast, I believe is the correct terminology.
I think it's the Diane Weist coast.
Ooh, I love Diane Weist. Have you ever seen Bullets Over Broadway?
I have. She's great in that.
Yeah, I loved her on Law & Order.
So Alex is going to be here for the next couple weeks.
Yeah.
So we'll see more of him, but just know that... that when he does disappear, that's where he's disappeared to.
Yes. You'll see my byline at least.
And he'll still be working for this godforsaken organization.
Indeed.
You can't escape that easily.
There's no God here.
And with that though, I think we got to bring the show to a close. It's been a ton of fun. I want to thank Sarah and Josh. I want to thank Will and Norm and Daniel and Jeff for the awful Easter egg stuff. I want to thank you guys, whatever your names are, I think myself, I think Ubisoft for providing us with the game to show on the show, all of our callers, all of the rest of the staff here at Whiskey Media, Internet Ben, Big Ben, thanks for another day of question asking. That's it for the happy hour. Have a good weekend. You don't have to go home, but you can't stay here.
Gears Code.
Oh, Gears Code.
And we have Gears Codes! We have Gears Code 3!
I was waiting for you to say it!
We have codes for the Gears of War 3 multiplayer beta that are gonna roll right now, so if you wanna play some of that this weekend, be the first one to punch one of these in. We'll see ya! Thank you, Jeff.
I knew it.